On today's show,
we discuss the Warriors' impressive 72nd win of the season and their place in NBA history.
It's time for Brent Berry to hand out hardware in the third annual Bonies.
And we'll make quite the mess in a brand new edition of Weekend Whoopsies.
It's Monday, April 11th. The starter starts now.
Good evening, Sweet World, and welcome to The Starters. Whether you're listening to the podcast or joining us live on NBA TV or a little bit later on YouTube, we're happy to have you. I'm J.E. Skeets, and alongside me, as always, that's Tass Mellis.
We're going to make your Monday so great, you'll forget it's Monday. Matter of fact, it's Tuesday.
Wow. To his right, it's the international man of mystery, taking it to the max, Lee Ellis.
Friend.
Lily.
Lily. And last, certainly not least, Starters blog editor, Trey Kirby.
Hey-o!
Hey-o!
Trey, what do you have for us this Monday?
Well, I'm here at the internet looking for your best tweets at #TheStarters, and we're going to start today's show out in Denver with a fan sign. Why, you might ask? Because these two Starters fans got engaged at the Nuggets game over the weekend.
Yeah!
Give them a hand. John Harder and Sarah Bassler, a couple of Spurs fans, hit up that Nuggets game where he popped the question courtside while wearing a Boban tee. She said yes. So congratulations to them. I'm hoping that's a Justin's ring. Shout out to Justin's. But hey, shout out to the happy couple. We hope they stay together. We've had some engagement mishaps here on the show, but I'm thinking this one's gonna hold. So if you ever get engaged, you involve us, send us an email, send us a tweet, #TheStarters or thestarters@nba.com. We'll get you on the show.
We're pretty clear they're still engaged, right?
As far as I know, yeah.
Good to know.
At least as of yesterday, when they got engaged.
All right, great stuff. Good way to start the show here. On tonight's show, Brent Berry's going to join us live in studio to hand out some NBA hardware. It is the third annual Bonies, and of course we got Weekend Whoopsies. But we start with Golden State tying a little bit of history. The Warriors, yeah, they've done it. Driven by an awesome second half from Steph Curry, Golden State beat San Antonio 92-86 on Sunday night for its record-tying 72nd win. The Warriors can surpass the 95-96 Bulls and complete the single greatest regular season in NBA history with a win over the Grizzlies on Wednesday night at the Roracle. So let's play a little fill-in-the-blank. We asked you to play along on Twitter. Fill-in-the-blank here, #TheStarters. Most impressive part of the Warriors winning 72 games is what?
They've won 72 games. Isn't that impressive enough?
It is.
Their toughness and resiliency is the most impressive thing. And I know that sounds like cliche, sports speak, but this team is going to be the first team ever to go an entire season without losing consecutive games. That is so impressive.
That's
what Steve Kerr calls the most impressive thing. Because last night, second night of a back-to-back, this was a really physical ball game. Everyone was throwing their bodies around. No one was getting called for it. No real whistles. But the Warriors stepped up. This could have been a game where they decided, this isn't for me. We're just going to relax. We're going to shoot from the outside. No, Steph Curry got into it. Everybody got into it and fought extremely hard. And I think the difference between this Warriors team, which is going to get to 73 and have the most wins ever on Wednesday.
You locking it in?
Let's lock it in.
All right.
I thought they were going to do it when they got to 69. This was obviously the biggest hurdle.
Yeah.
They did it. I think the little difference between the Bulls and the Warriors is that that Bulls team had Jordan coming off two seasons where they didn't win it. Where he had the little retirement playing baseball.
Yeah.
They came from a different place than this Warriors team. This Warriors team just finished on top, and now they have to do that night in and night out. They don't have that drive where, we haven't won this in two seasons like the Bulls did.
Yeah.
It's incredible that they have that drive night in and night out.
What about you, Lee?
Yeah, they're 18-2 on the second night of back-to-backs, which just shows how after a loss or just a second night, they can refocus and get back to where they need to be.
And we said on Friday, sitting here, we were looking at that Grizzlies game, going, well, maybe they'll try and blow the Grizzlies out on Saturday night. Then they can sort of rest their guys and be ready on Sunday against the Spurs. And that was the exact opposite of what happened. The Grizzlies put up one heck of a fight.
Yeah.
You know, they're down late in that game. They scrap and get that win. And then they turn around and beat the Spurs. By the way, hadn't lost at home all season long. You're right. That's the resiliency, the toughness, and wanting the record. That comes down to it, too.
Yeah.
That's what Jordan wanted when he played on the Bulls, 95-96. They had that 69-70 win mark. In sight, they wanted it, they went and got it, and that's what the Warriors have done here.
And they lost game 81 like the Warriors very well could have against the Spurs.
I think the secret was the Warriors wore their home jerseys and the Spurs wore their road.
Maybe.
So it sort of tricked them into thinking it was actually a home game for the Warriors. Just crazy to think that's Tim Duncan's first loss ever to the Golden State Warriors in San Antonio since he came into the league.
But toughness and resiliency is a cliche that doesn't really get linked with the Warriors very much because they're a three-point shooting team, and that's why I wanted to say it as well, just because they shoot from the outside. That is their MO. And because we've heard so many legends sort of say, hey, this team isn't tough enough. This team doesn't have the same fight and resiliency that we used to have to play with on the offensive end because defenses were tougher then. It needs to be said. This team is the first ever not to lose consecutive games. It's marvelous.
And you saw it there, too. 34 road victories in this, again, unbelievable season. So 73, they go for it on Wednesday night, 10:30 p.m. Eastern on ESPN. Yeah, you'd have to imagine the last time they played the Grizzlies at home, they beat them by 50. Mm. Yes, the game on Saturday night, very close, but I'd be sort of shocked if the Warriors don't pick up that magical number 73. Unbelievable weekend for them. All right, moving on here, guys. Sunday afternoon, the Clips beat the Mavs 98-91. The loss keeping Dallas in seventh place. Meanwhile, the two teams behind them, both the Jazz and Rockets, picked up wins. Utah used a 24-0 run in the third quarter to beat the Nuggets, while Harden helped the Rockets to a 20-point win over Kobe and the Lakers. So the West standings at the bottom. We know six teams that are dancing come this weekend, but still two spots remain for the final three teams, the Mavs, Jazz, and Rockets, separated by just two games. So this is a tough question, but I'll throw it at everyone watching and you guys, of course, here at the table. Fill in the blank. The team that won't make the West playoffs is who?
It's the Rockets. I think their nine lives are up. They have come into this season without a lot of desire, I think you can put it that way, and they don't control their fate anymore, while Utah and Dallas does. Yeah. I think despite Utah playing Dallas tonight, I think the Jazz will win out, and Dallas, despite I think coming up short tonight, they play the Spurs on Wednesday night at home. Spurs might sit some guys, so I think they'll get a win there. Well, the Rockets, you know, they have Minnesota tonight, they have Sacramento, but as I said, even if they win those two games, it's not going to work out, and this is tonight's implications here. This is what's on the line tonight. Yeah. This, you'll see guys get in or out based on these playoff scenarios here.
Yeah, the Rockets need the Mavs to win big time tonight because then they pull into a tie with wins with the Jazz, and that's who basically they're fighting against. The Rockets do play the Wolves and the Kings. Two winnable games, but this year with the Rockets, no game has really been winnable. So if things work out for them tonight, then they have to go to Sacramento and win on Wednesday. I mean, that's their last roll of the dice.
Yeah, what's interesting, too, with the Utah Jazz schedule is their final game is, of course, against Kobe.
Yeah, in L.A.
In his final game ever in L.A. And not that the Lakers are a great team by any means. This has been a horrible season. Their worst season in franchise history. But you wonder,
there's a lot of emotion.
Of electricity and the emotion in the building, whether the Lakers can pull out a win there, sort of behind Kobe's final last hurrah. So that's not going to be an easy win by any means.
The Jazz have held it together, too, lately. 11-5 in their last 16, but they did lose that one to the Clippers on the weekend, which really could have separated them. So that one might come back to bite them a little bit, but it's going to be exciting.
I love it because the playoffs sort of have already started.
Yeah.
That's the best part about this, when you get these races at the end of the season. All right, moving on. Jumping to the East, the Indiana Pacers, they are going to the postseason. On Sunday, Miles Turner dropped 28-10 as Indy crushed the Nets 129-105 to clinch an East playoff spot. Indy controlled its fate, and they knocked the Bulls out of the playoffs for the first time since 08. We will not see Chicago losing to LeBron James in the playoffs. No, I'm sorry. They're not going into it, which is unbelievable, especially the expectations we had coming in for Chicago at the start of the season. You see the Eastern Conference standings right there. We know all eight teams in the East. We just don't know the matchups because a lot still to be decided. But I'm going to ask you, Trey, because you're the big Bulls fan here. I want you to fill in the blank. The Bulls' biggest question mark going into next season is what?
Who they are, because this year's Bulls team really had no identity at all, and I kind of laid that blame on the front office because they fired their defensive genius head coach, handed over their defensive roster to an offensive guy who finished 26th in offensive efficiency, and to me it kind of starts with the old guys, in particular Pau Gasol, who I think is going to be on the way out. All indications are that the Bulls want to keep Joakim Noah ahead of Pau Gasol now, and I think that's right. Just because if you're trying to play a fast, up-tempo style, you're not going to want Powell as your main offensive big guy. He's not super fast. He doesn't love playing in the pick and roll, the pick and pop. I mean, he can do that. He's going to be good for a good contending team, I'm sure, putting up points. But if you're trying to get to an offensive team, you got to get a little bit younger, a little bit more athletic, and figure out really what you're trying to do with Fred Hoiberg.
Yeah, I think they also have to figure out what they're going to do with Derrick Rose and Jimmy Butler, because I think one of those guys has to be the main man on the team. And I wonder if it's going to be Rose or if it's going to be Butler. I think Butler is clearly the better player at this stage. But at the same time, he also provides more trade value if the Bulls do decide. We've heard rumours that they're thinking about trading him.
Can they not improve, though, their chemistry and their communication? And
Jimmy Butler says they can.
Yeah.
But I think from what we've seen on the court, it doesn't look like that to me. It looks like Jimmy wants to be the man and he doesn't like sharing that spotlight with Derrick Rose. That's just my
It's been kind of tough on them, too, because Derrick Rose has been out so much. Butler's been injured a lot, too. They haven't had a lot of on-court time together. That being said, they're both better when the other one's sitting. Yeah. So what are you doing?
What a weird season for the Bulls. Crazy. Jimmy Butler's an all-star again. Pau Gasol, despite being 35, is still a monster double-double-wise.
All-star as well.
Derrick Rose played a lot of games, looked good at times, and they went 7-1 against the top two teams in the East, in the Cavs and the Raptors, and here they are now making the playoffs.
They love playing LeBron.
Yeah, it turns out you have to play hard against all the teams, though.
Yeah.
We couldn't get up for games.
We just learned that. All right, got to take a break. When we return, Brent Berry joins us live in studio to hand out some of his end-of-the-year hardware, the Bonies, when we return. This Friday, April 15th, 8 p.m. Eastern on NBA TV, it's the Starters' third annual Starties, where we hand out the six major NBA awards, as well as Fan of the Year and Wedgie of the Year, hosted by Kristen Ledlow.
Red carpet starts
big
at 7,
time.
Right?
Yeah. It's big time. 8 p.m. Eastern?
That's right.
Wow.
They gave us
prime time. Cancel your Friday plans. We're handing out awards, y'all. Awesome.
Richard Deitch, check out those numbers on Friday night. but before we get to the Starties,
maybe Richard will have you on his podcast on Monday following Friday edition.
Hey, we'll still be partying.
Before the Starties, we got the Bonies here. The 2016 Bonies, the third annual Bonies.
Why don't I have that chair? That's just two questions.
We got it upstairs.
I don't know.
I want to get that chair back. Good to see you guys.
Bones, thanks for joining us. As always, we always love the Bonies here because this is where you hand out.
Yeah, no player wants the Bony, by the way.
No, for sure.
Yeah, I'm pretty positive.
Well, we don't know that. Let's get right to the major award.
Yeah.
We'll go through all of your awards like when we get to the end here, but your major award, let's start with the MVP. It's obvious, I assume, that you're going with who?
There's a drum roll, Matt, upstairs.
Why not?
Steph Curry this year, clear-cut MVP. I mean, having one of the best offensive seasons
ever
in the history of the league. Obviously, we know what their team is doing. They will set that mark on Wednesday, by the way. I think they're thrashed Memphis in that game. There's just too much good going on there. But Steph, the most valuable player, and really... There's an incredible jump from what it is that he was doing last year to this year, and it sort of diminishes how great he was last year.
Right.
But the talk about Steph being the most improved player as well as the MVP is so legitimate, in my opinion, and so encouraging, in my opinion, with regards to the game of basketball itself and for young players who think they've arrived or think that they've done something. We're up. I'm in the coast mode now.
Right.
Steph Curry is there. There's no coast mode for him. And for him to make that kind of jump behind what his team has done on an individual basis, I think has been an interesting story as well.
Is it going to be unanimous, do you think?
I think it will be for the first time.
You do?
Yeah, I do. I think because of the dominance of what his team has done all year long, and I think Michael was not unanimous that year.
No.
The Bulls won the same. Carl? Yes. Did Carl get votes and Shaq during that year?
Gary Payton, I think, got some.
Oh, really?
Well.
Okay,
I think so.
No one's ever been unanimous.
Yeah,
I think that this year, maybe the only other guy that sneaks in with votes could be Russell Westbrook, given the individual season.
I feel it should be unanimous. But.
And maybe so, but maybe the fact that the Golden State Warriors did what they did against San Antonio.
And Oklahoma City as well.
That could be interesting. But Steph, what a year for that kid.
He's going to win the award. It's just by how many. Right. It's basically what's going to come.
He's going to lead the league in scoring while shooting probably 50, 40, 90 and smashing his own three-point record by over 100.
On the greatest probably regular season.
Exactly.
Tom Haberstroh did the numbers of the MVP that's jumped the most, and he's right there with Larry Bird. And what can you say? He's going to hopefully get 30 points per game.
I don't know. That's enough. Well, you had me at Larry Bird.
Okay, well, forget most improved here right now. Who do you have as coach of the year? Because I think this is an interesting one because you can make a case for a lot of guys.
I think you guys could tell me, drum roll, if you guys believe that the league should split this award between an East Coast and a West Coast coach. I think that they should. Steve Kerr will get it. I mean, how do you take it away from a guy that just set the NBA's all-time winning mark during the regular season? Personally, I have enjoyed the jobs done by both Dwayne Casey and Terry Stotts on each coast. I think that Terry Stotts in Portland And Neil O'Shea, give him credit as a general manager, to find guys to fit into what their culture represents. But to lose the four starters and to be competitive in the West, even though it's a little bit down from the years previous, has been amazing. And Casey, the first 54-win season, or first 50-game season that Toronto's ever seen in terms of their franchise's history. The thing is, though, Tass, about him is they didn't do it with the guy that they went out that thought was going to be the most impactful guy for their season, in Damari Carroll, being a huge reason why they're going to make this jump. It was, I'm going to pull the best out of Bismack Biyombo. I'm going to get some great minutes and establish confidence in Terrence Ross. Mm-hmm. I'm going to put Patrick Patterson in a conversation to be the sixth man of the year, who I think should get some consideration. So Dwayne Casey and Terry Stotts did remarkable jobs. I think Steve gets it.
You think Steve ultimately wins it?
I think so.
Dwayne Casey was lucky to even be there. Remember how they finished against the Wizards, and you thought that he might have been fired. He's bounced back.
And let's not leave out Steve Clifford, Brad Stevens. Oh, there's other jobs. Pops, the most wins Pops ever had, and you're not going to mention his name.
But you've got Kerr and Walton on the ballot. They're going to take some votes away from each other.
Yeah,
that's the odd thing. They have to put them together.
And you know what? Milk and saucer table too, because they will fight.
Yeah, you think they're gonna throw down?
All right, what about another tough category? At least in the eyes of most people, sixth man of the year. Who do you have winning the Bonies for sixth man of the year?
That's the toughest one. I think Enes Kanter will win it this year. Mm.
Yeah.
And I know Jamal Crawford is sort of this. I don't know what it is about Jamal Crawford, but he's always the favorite.
Yeah, everybody when in doubt, give it to Jamal Crawford.
Give it to JC, who would be the third time winner of this award, but. I think Kanter, the way that he stabilized their bench, at least on one end of the floor, is the reason why he's going to get it. I know with Blake Griffin being out, you go, oh, well, Jamal saved the Clippers season.
That's the narrative. So, I know he had a game winner this weekend, but he's actually been pretty brutal.
He has been bad. You look at the numbers, the field goal percentage, and I know Jamal, he's a great guy, but I would give it to Enes Kanter. I'm going to bring a couple names in, too, though. Evan Turner.
Yep.
Great year for the Boston Celtics as their sixth man to stabilize their bench unit. Such a tough cover, points, rebounds, assists. Patrick Patterson, I mentioned him before. I think he's done a great job in Toronto this year. Dennis Schroeder in Atlanta. Mm. Iguodala, I'm probably not as high on the list this year for many people, but certainly a huge impact for the Warriors.
I'd vote for him.
Tristan Thompson, Ed Davis.
Ed Davis, a great one.
Yeah, I mean, lots of guys who did some things. Let's just not think points. Let's try to get outside of this box.
Yeah.
Not just the points in production.
And here's a look at all of the 2016.
We're all in agreement about the rookie of the year, are we not?
Probably.
That should be unanimous.
Yeah, there is no debate there. Great job by Cat.
And, you know, Brent taking, of course, Kawhi Leonard for Defensive Player of the Year. I think that should be a runaway winner as well. And CJ McCollum for Most Improved. A lot of people, at least.
That's another award where we got to think outside of the opportunity in just more minutes. But CJ's year has been incredible, the consistency with that many minutes given.
But as you said, you would think about giving it to Steph, MIP.
Absolutely.
It's been unbelievable.
Well worth the discussion.
CJ also hosts a radio show.
This is true. And none of those players that we mentioned will get a Bony. Unless they stay out late.
Back with the starters, time for some weekend whoopsies.
Kobe had a monster 35 on Sunday, but Friday, he had a couple misplays against the Pellies, including this lefty layup. It goes lefty and a little short.
Dunk it.
Oh, Friday night in Denver, the Nuggets gave us the Lion King cam. Take your baby and hold him up like Simba. get Rocky up there as well. That is a brilliant idea.
Awesome. That's a great one.
My favorite cam.
Friday, Kristaps Porzingis sat out, but he had nowhere to sit. I mean, he's really squeezing in there. To his left is Kevin Sardine. to his right, there's no room for him.
Yeah.
He's a big man.
Yeah, lucky he's skinny, though.
Look sharp, though.
Speaking of looking sharp, Jeremy Lin with the double ponytail. Mm. What does it mean?
Trey, did you used to have one of these at any point?
I've tried it in sixth grade. Left it back there, though.
Grizzlies, Jamichael Green. Watch him on the left here. A great putback.
Oh, yeah.
Wow,
monster. Yeah, you deserve to flex.
Yeah.
Here's the whoopsie. Oh.
That is good.
He's a little green at celebrating, I guess. Tumbles.
Well, he stays up. Not bad.
Yeah. He saves it.
Steph Curry, great weekend for him. Had some fun pregame hijinks. There he is putting a basketball. Wait, is it gonna drop? Is it good? Oh, it's in! Yes! Though he found out on Sunday that his buddy Jordan Spieth quadruple bogeyed the 12th hole. at the Masters. Yeah, not happy to hear that. Oh man, wow, he took it quite hard. And then he was just like a kid messing around here.
Look at him.
Yeah, he's got a lot of energy before the game. Oh, trust fall, no one there. And then a little volleyball. What is going on?
Yeah, Boga just warming up at the line.
Did look like volleyball lineups. Last game in Arco Arena, some Kings legends, Yogi Stewart, Brad Miller, and Olden Polynice. Is this innovative or cheating? I mean, that's cheating.
That's innovative.
No, I think that's innovative.
You can't get up. You got to ride this cycle.
Saturday, this Bulls fan airballs a half-court shot and gives Benny a concussion. He did not return. He had to do the concussion protocol.
He should have won a prize for hitting Benny on the head, though, shouldn't he?
Yeah.
On Sunday, the Knicks, Cleanthony Early. Check him on the press row right there. He rode that table. WrestleMania was a week ago. They're going to invite him next year. He's going to ride the announcer's table. Really well done. Although at the end, he's kind of puzzled. Maybe I shouldn't have done that.
Same game. The Knicks training staff fixing up Grant here. Check out this kid's reaction. I don't know if he's like just blown away by the little blood.
Never seen blood. Paul George's Pacers locked up a playoff spot Sunday, so some fans gave him a present. Straight popcorn.
Aw.
Sharing is caring.
Present's a little corny, just like that joke right there.
And look at him. He likes it. Stop. Nice. And back to MSG. Here's Terrence Ross of the Raptors. Just throwing the ball down to the ref, though I think he misses him. I was trying to hit the ref.
Get your hand up, ref.
Yeah, that's just sails into the crowd.
I love the cool walk. All right. Nobody will notice.
There it is. Great weekend. Or whoopsies in the NBA, as it always is. Gotta take one more break. When we come back, Lili's very solid play.
It's not that one.
You? Back with the starters with a pie to the face on the line. We look at tonight's pick and play. Three of us taking the Wolves at home. Trey, the only one, taking the Rockets on the road. Lee. VSP time. Let's do it.
We're heading out to Los Angeles for a beautiful one here from the Dallas Mavericks. Starts with Raymond Felton penetrating, fizzes around the perimeter, ends with Devin Harris, and that is a
swish ball.
That sure is. Here it is again. Beautiful ball movement. The Mavs do this a lot. Yeah. Great to see them finish off the season well. This. That's beautiful. That's what I call a very solid play.
Gosh darn it, that was a very solid play. But now it's time for the highlight that wasn't. It seems like their highlight that wasn't all over the league right now. Steph Curry, the king of the highlight that was. End of the third quarter, just give him the ball so he can do this.
Oh.
Felt so good coming off the hand.
Yeah, you knew that was going in.
Oh,
yeah. Right away.
He's probably hit 400 threes this year, including the ones that haven't counted.
Yeah, he talks to the refs. Come on, that's good. It's down, video review.
Knew it.
Look at the refs.
It was after the whistle, he knew it. He knows what he's doing at all times.
Great stuff. Highlight that wasn't. Tonight on NBA TV, we've got the doubleheader. Hawks and Cavs gets underway at 7 p.m. Eastern, followed by Kings and Suns. Kings and Suns. Kings and Suns.
All right. Thanks for joining us, folks. And remember, you don't have to go to Tahiti to have a treat.
Embrace the night, people.